Hey everyone, before we start this week's show, I wanted to let you know about a not-for-profit that I just truly became aware of its mission over the last week or so with the Black Lives Matter protests in Philadelphia. That charity is called the Philadelphia Bail Fund at phillybailfund.org. They're a nonprofit that seeks to end the practice of cash bail in Philadelphia. Now, I didn't really know what that meant or what that entailed until just a short while ago, so I'm happy to share it with you, and if you already know, then hey, you've probably already donated. When a person is accused of a crime and they cannot afford to put up a cash bail, they are remanded into a city jail for, on average, 100 days. And that person is presumed innocent prior to the fair trial, just like everyone else. As of 2018, more than 70% of the inmates in the Philadelphia city jails were not convicted of any crime, but they're awaiting trial because they weren't able to pay bail. In fact, in the last week, the average cash bail amount paid in Philadelphia was about $7,300. I'm not pulling that out of nowhere. I'm getting it off phillybailfund.org's website. If you're out there, you've been watching what's going on, not just in Philadelphia, but in this country for the last couple of weeks, and you want to do something and you want to put your money in a place that can help, I can think of very few more worthy places than the Philadelphia Bail Fund at phillybailfund.org. Okay, let's do the show. Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for joining me here on the show, 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast. I think I've got a great show for you this week. I sit down with Jay Levin of Turtle Studios. He's the general manager, executive producer over at Turtle Studios here in Philadelphia. And we talk about, well, we talk about a lot of things, but mostly what we talk about is how Turtle is starting to figure out how to conduct studio business safely once it's deemed okay for recording studios to open up again. We'll talk more about Jay and more about Turtle Studios in just a moment. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, check out 25oclockpod.com. That's where you can get everything. All the episodes are there for streaming or for downloading. You can find our mailing list and sign up for it. You can check us out on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Find the Friends and Neighbors page. That's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you like an artist that you hear, you like some music, and you want to know more information, go to that Friends and Neighbors page and check it out. 25oclockpod.com. All right. So as I alluded in the cold open, lots been going on in Philadelphia and in this country over the last couple of weeks. And, you know, over the last many decades and few hundred years, there's been a lot going on. But with the ramp up of the protests against police violence, not just in Philadelphia, but all over the country, this episode was set and ready to go a good week and a half ago. But I held it back, and I got the blessing from Jay, too, that we wanted to hold it back because just last week just did not seem to be the time for us to be talking about recording studios and things like that. It's a very interesting conversation. It has import. It has meaning. But last week, there were definitely much bigger, much more important things to focus on. And the last thing I needed to do was shove more content onto the internet saying, hey, look at this. I made a podcast. That's what's going on there. That's why there was no episode last week. But let me give you a little bit of insight and a little bit of context for the conversation that you're about to hear between me and Jay Levin, conducted, of course, over Zoom and remote recording technology. Jay Levin is the general manager and executive producer over at Turtle Studios, which is a large, very excellent studio here in Philadelphia. He and I have known each other for quite a while, just as two guys in the music world, two guys whose paths cross occasionally, two guys who share a whole lot of mutual friends. I wanted to talk to Jay. He reached out to me and told me that they were putting together I guess like a list of rules would be a really redactive way to think about it. He's putting together a document and some information that he was calling creating safely, a sort of a constantly changing and evolving set of practices and safety standards to adhere to in the recording studio to make working in a recording studio more safe, more secure, just a better experience amidst the coronavirus than maybe it was before. And of course, he was not agitating to open studios immediately. In fact, quite the opposite. We both agreed that it was important that these places stay closed up, that they don't have people pouring in and out of them right now until we can figure out the best way to go about doing that. And that's what I think the guys at Turtle Studios are working on, and they're by no means claiming that their answers are the be-all, end-all. They are not the people coming up with the ultimate safety standards, but they're getting the ball rolling, and they're getting the conversation going. It all has to start somewhere, and I'm glad it's starting with folks at Turtle, and I'm glad it's starting with guys like Jay Levin. Hopefully that helps you a little bit. You can find Turtle Studios. You can find a lot of their music up at turtlestudios.bandcamp.com. And if you go to facebook.com/turtlestudios or just look up Turtle Studios on Facebook, you'll get to read some of these guidelines and practices that they've started to draft. And it's very, very cool. You can see how they're starting going forward. I don't know as of the recording of when I'm recording this right now if Philadelphia recording studios are allowed to open back up again. I don't think so, but I could be incorrect on that. I know New York State just got the all clear for recording studios a day or so ago from when I'm recording this. It's happening. People are going to want to come back, and people are going to want to exercise their livelihood and their creativity. But I think it's very, very important, and the guys at Turtle Studios think this too. We think it's very, very important to really, really examine what a safety plan and what safety standards look like in the recording studio right now. Now, I don't want to give away the whole conversation. We get way into it. So let's just do it. Let's hear my conversation with Jay Levin from Turtle Studios here on 25 O'Clock.
All right, well, this can be the first thing if you want, and that is I want you to know that I'm paying you the ultimate compliment, which is I'm not doing any post-processing on my own voice track here. I'm sending it to you raw, and I'm completely trusting that you are the expert at this, and you're going to not have me sounding like a nasally, you know, jackass. You know, this is a I'm completely trusting you with that.
There's a lot of interesting stuff that you want to talk about, and you've sort of briefed me a little bit in advance and given me some stuff to read about what you guys are doing at Turtle, not just on an everyday basis. I'm always interested in what's going on at Turtle, but in more in context of social distancing and businesses closing and essential businesses closing, and now how do you reopen as a studio with no real 100% sure cure in sight. But I wanted to kind of start at the beginning as briefly as we can, because I'm sure there's a lot of people out there who aren't familiar with Turtle Studios.
Sadly, yes.
So. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's there's tons of people who aren't familiar with tons of stuff that I think is cool, and vice versa. I'm not familiar with tons of stuff that probably other people think that I should know about. So,
oh, yeah. I mean... I do feel that, like, just letting people know that we exist is, for us, maybe more than half the battle, maybe 90% of the battle. Like, if people know something about us, then we're going to get to work on the projects that, you know, that we should, you know, and, you know, I don't worry about too much else, really. So go ahead. Tell me about us. I don't know.
Did Turtle exist before you were a part of it?
Not really. It was sort of just getting started with an old partner who sort of left the scene. You know, he and I stopped working together, 2003. So that's, you know, Turtle as people understand it today sort of starts after that. It really starts when Jeff Hyatt and I started working together, and my good friend Sandy Selznick helped me sort of rebuild the studio and relaunch it, and we rethought it and brought in a whole new crew of people. And actually the very first session that Jeff ran was for a student group led by Ross Bellinois.
So,
we really think of that as like, that's really the day. It's something like February 5th. I have it in my calendar. Like, that's the day when it all happened. And so, yeah, that version of Turtle is now 15 years old. And a lot of great stuff, you know, but that Ross and Jeff have worked on, and then a whole series of people who were sort of brought along and worked with them and learned from them, as I have.
Yeah. Now, I know you guys occupy, it's the old Philadelphia International rooms, right?
No, it's Alpha International.
Alpha International, yeah. Okay.
Philadelphia International, I think there was a fire there, and that's, you know, all the other vintage studios are basically gone. At this point, they've been turned into condos. I think they literally have all been turned into condos.
So we're saying about 15 years ago is the beginning of what you consider Turtle as what you guys are doing now. And back then, I mean, this was certainly not. This was always a music city. I always have to sort of check myself right there. It's always a great music city. There's always things happening. It's just maybe in the last decade or so, the rest of the world started to give notice to elements of it. But what do you see as the role of Turtle as a studio, like, throughout these years, aside from just being a recording studio that people can record records in? I know studios always want to see themselves as more than just a spot to record tape. You know what I mean?
Yeah. The role of Turtle Studios is really to elevate what an artist is trying to do. And that I think that maybe one thing that sets us apart is that we take a lot of time trying to understand what the artist is trying to do. You know, what one of my favorite expressions is about communication. It says, the problem with communication is the illusion that it has occurred. And you know, what that means is that, you know, and by the way, talking about music, talking about recording, you know, it kind of just sounds stupid when you try to talk about it. It's difficult to talk about it. But even if it wasn't difficult, someone tries to explain to you what they have in mind, their vision, this thing that's deeply personal to them and very specific to their musical sensibilities and their artistic sensibilities. You can't really get that out of a quick conversation anyway. You know, even if it wasn't this elusive, difficult to verbalize topic, you can't get that out of a quick conversation. So, I mean, we really take some time to get to know people and understand where they're coming from as artists, as musicians, and what they need, and really, like, what are their goals? What would represent, like, a full realization of their vision? We sweat all kinds of details. We sweat the quality of the instruments that are at Turtle. We sweat the quality of the recording equipment. Most of all, we sweat the quality of everyone who's going to be involved with the artist, every person that's going to be involved, certainly the producer, definitely the engineers. We're, I think, extraordinarily picky about engineers, but then also, really, we're extraordinarily picky about everybody involved. And every musician who's invited to play on an album, it's never like an off-the-cuff decision. It's never like, you know, I just ran into my buddy last night. He'll come in and play the album. We have like a real conversation and think about like, who is the exact perfect person? There's such a wealth of talent in Philly that it's worth, like, you know, really thinking about who specific. I just think it's a big part of the musical DNA of an album is what musicians did you get to play on it? And so we spend a great deal of, you know, thought and effort on just figuring that out and always referencing, you know, those recommendations, those decisions are always referencing back to what is the artist's vision? What is the artist really trying to build here? What's the artist trying to say? And then for all of that, having sweated all of those little details, I will still tell you, and I think almost anybody who is any good at production will tell you, that the most important thing, the biggest trick is, can you somehow get the artist to be even better than they were coming in? Even like, especially, this is, you know, when this is most challenging is when the artist is already really good. And you say, like, is there anything we can do to actually help the artist find a new level, you know? And because there are artists who come in and sort of, like, are amazing right off the jump. And you say, all right, it's my job to see if there's some way to make them even better, to convince them to find a higher level, you know?
Yeah,
and that's
yeah.
That's the songwriting. And that's especially vocal performances. I think it's very important. But I mean, an album is only as good as the songs are. You know, that's not. There's, you know, I always tell people, it's like, we better work on that first, because there's no going back and editing that. You know, the songs have to be good.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And when you come to a place like Turtle with all the resources that you guys have available, you would hope that you had your ducks in a row, like when you come into a place like that, because you don't want to waste your own time. You don't want to waste the time of the people around you.
I actually caution people to say, don't wait too long. Don't feel like you need to get everything figured out before you come talk to us, because really one of the best things we can do is help you figure it out, is make it, and not in any way that we're bossing around the artist, but I always say putting together a record works much better as a dialogue than a monologue. And the sooner you start talking to someone who shares your vision, or you find someone who shares your vision and start talking to them and they're really invested in your vision, and you make it a dialogue instead of a monologue, the ideas start getting better a lot faster. Even though they're still maybe 70 to 90% still just the artist's ideas, you know, depending on the project. It's not that we're doing it, but it's just that, you know, creativity works better in dialogue.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Some of the best records I've ever worked on have been in situations where if someone were to walk into the room right in the moment in the middle of a conversation and not know who anyone in the room was, they would be hard pressed to tell you who was in charge in terms of like whose idea it was originally.
It points back to how incredibly important it is to be thoughtful about who you put in that room, because, you know, not everyone is capable of working on that level. I'm going to throw out one name. There are many I could throw out, but the first name that comes to mind is Jaron Olevsky. And Jaron is, you know, a superb musician. He's been Amos Lee's music director for many years, and he's a friend. And he is one of the most laid back, just nicest people that you could ever meet. And it's great to have people like that, you know, musicians like that in the studio for the overall vibe. But he's someone who's very well capable of taking the reins and giving something some extra creative direction if it needs it. But at the same time, he's not someone who's going to have a problem if the creative direction is already happening, is already in the room, and he can sort of sit back with it. And, you know, that's a special personality. And, you know, I think a lot of what we seek to do in those situations is, can we bring someone in who has really special talent as a musician and also has really special personality to be in a situation like that and not have it be any kind of, you know, turf situation. And just, and especially we're talking about musicians who really enjoy the process of serving the song. They get it, that nobody has to explain it to them. Before I called them, they already knew about that. Yeah. You know, I'll give you another example, an album that we're just finishing up, great singer-songwriter named Jay Carlos.
Oh, and I know Jay. Yeah, Barrel Fires.
Do you
Fires.
Know Jay?
Yeah. I met him at the Robert Hunter night at Ardmore Music Hall. We were both standing backstage together, realizing that there were a lot more people in the audience than we had originally expected.
Great guy.
Yeah.
And we got to produce the Barrel Fires EP last year, and that was a really cool experience. Have you heard that?
Yeah, yeah. I did a track. I showcased a track at one of the playlist episodes I've done since lockdown. I like his sound a lot. I really do.
So the band is a very busy bunch of guys, and Jay had a bunch of tunes that he really felt he needed to put out there in the world. So we're actually finishing up a full-length solo album for him right now. And
that's
so
great.
That was a situation, and it made me think of like Tommy Geddes on drums on that, of just being, he's got one of those really great personalities to be in that situation, you know, and be in the moment, able to creatively contribute, but also just able to go with the flow and with whatever anyone else is directing. Because, you know, look, as much as you might like to see a situation where you can't tell who's in charge, the truth is most sessions at Turtle, the great majority of sessions, there is very definitely a specific person who is producing that session. And it's actually very common for there to be four or five people in the room or in the rooms who have significant producing experience, but everyone knows who's the producer that day, you know, and that's, well, it just clarifies. It means there's a lot less wasted time and energy. And that also that person who's producing that day is responsible for having put a lot of thought and preparation into the material and having worked with the artist to make sure that they are really of one mind, they have a unified vision for how the music is supposed to come out that day. And none of the other musicians in the room have done that, likely. I mean, there might have been a rehearsal. It's great if there has been. But the producer's really, like, you know, the artist's vision has been entrusted to the producer to do this complicated thing today and make sure it comes out according to the artist's vision.
I know back in March, right before all non-essential businesses got shut down and before we all had to go home so that we weren't endangering others, how were you guys doing just as like the first quarter of the year going forward? Were you guys pretty busy over there at the studio?
Yeah, there's ebbs and flows, I think, with any studio or any producer, but we've been fairly busy pretty consistently for several years now. There's always sort of little sessions that come and go here and there, but when things started to get shut down mid-March, we were sort of fortunate that there was sort of a lot of projects that were in the middle of production, a lot of recording and editing going on, and that it was about to sort of flip to where most of those projects were ready to be more focusing on mixing and eventually mastering. I think we have about 11 albums, 10, maybe 10 albums and a few singles that are going to be coming out, I think, between now and the end of the year. That, you know, so that's, there was a lot of work in progress. A lot of it is pretty much ready to go now. Some of it's Dr. Guy Ramsey's spiritual record is coming out in, what day is it? I think the 31st. Yeah, I think it's coming out on Sunday. So, you know, that's a full-length album. And, you know, I said Jay's album, a bunch of jazz records, actually. Mm-hmm. We had like a bumper crop of jazz records over the last year to work on, and that's been a real joy for me. You know, I'm a big jazz fan myself.
You guys were working on a fairly large film project, or a film performance project. Am I right?
What we were working on was partnering with a film director to start doing more live stream broadcasts of festivals and sort of, you know, large concert events, and trying to bring sort of a production quality to that where both sound and picture would be more in line with what you would expect from like a well-financed concert film, as opposed to, or, you know, the closest thing to it out there now is like what Fish is doing. You know, mm-hmm. like Fish has pretty high quality audio and video for their concerts. And so it's basically, you know, we have been partnering with someone to build out, basically a new venture to, you know, be able to bring that to, you know, any kind of festival.
This was all a project going into the works before it became evident that that was like the only way anyone was going to get anything out.
Right. No, we were going into clubs. I think we were looking at it as like, you know, like the TLA or bigger is what mm-hmm. is the venues we were looking at. And we experimented in some smaller clubs, but we were really looking at festivals is mainly what we wanted to do. And, you know, the sound at that point comes very complicated because either you have to integrate with the live sound and the monitor mixer, or you have to become all of those things. Mm-hmm. And so there was a moment where I said, geez, if depending on the festivals that want to use us, we might end up having to bring out a sound crew of like 10 or 12 people. And that's a little larger than I'm used to being, than Turtle is used to being. So we were sort of getting those people lined up and trained up, and we were, you know, investing in the right equipment and sort of just going into certain clubs and doing live stream shows and sort of beta testing the partnership.
Yeah.
And it was an exciting thing. Yeah. We weren't planning on doing any of that at Turtle. Now we're looking at doing it at Turtle because now the venues are closed. So.
I just find it interesting that you were starting to lay the groundwork to this sort of style of putting music out there and putting performances out there, that if you talk to people in the first quarter of this year and said like, well, what if you just did it from homes or from studios? You probably would have thought like, well, yeah, maybe we'll do something like that, but we want to get out in the world. And, you know, now that's not as much of an option anymore.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very strange thing that doing this stuff at the studio is actually easier than what we were planning to do. Like, you know,
absolutely,
to sort of,
yeah.
To bring all the video equipment in and set up for a shoot in a matter of a few hours, even aside from the audio, just the video part is a huge effort, and it's kind of insane, actually. And and you know, really what we're trying to do, and this is similar to what we've always done in terms of production, is to sort of say, if there's an expectation you have of like a major label artist that there's going to be a certain kind of quality to their concert, you know, to their live stream concert, then we're saying, all right, we're going to make that available to local bands as well. And, you know, it's probably more, you know, mid-level bands or regional artists who would have taken advantage of it, but we definitely were going to be working with a bunch of signed artists as well. And that's really what we've always tried to do, is basically to say, you know, a record that sounds like you know, that sounds extremely expensive, you know, is available to you. We know how to do it in a way that's only, I'll say, somewhat expensive. But, you know, obviously, everything is relative.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
What we do is extremely expensive from the point of view of probably most people.
Yeah.
As much as we try to, you know, work that number down.
What were some of the immediate things you guys were doing after closing to kind of keep work going and to just to keep your engineers working and to keep some semblance of activity happening while none of you could, like, go into the studio and record?
Well, we've basically ceded the studio to the two main engineers who have been sort of the everyday engineers for the last couple of years, and that's being Doug Ross and Sean Svatlanak. And Jeff Hyatt was coming in and doing sessions sometimes, and we basically ceded it to Doug and Sean. And there was significant amount of mixing and mastering work to do. As I said, like, we were sort of pivoting to a point where we mostly had mixing and mastering work ahead of us. So to some extent, for the first month, you know, work just sort of continued as it, you know, not extremely different than it otherwise might have, just because we had work to do without any changes. And what that allowed me to do is to work with the other guys on saying, all right, how are we going to adapt and make sure that our capabilities are everything they can be if we can't get whole groups of people in the room together in quite the same way anymore? And so I set up my home studio, which I have not done since 2003 and had no interest in doing. I really liked going to the studio and just sort of listening on a stereo at home or in my car. But now I have a home studio, so yay. And it's so lame that I'm unexcited about it, I know.
No, I completely understand the attitude right there, where, like, you have one of the larger, more sophisticated studios of this city at your fingertips because you run it. Why would you need to build some sort of, for lack of a better term, half-assed version of that out of your study or something like that when you could?
Well, especially considering, you know, my role, like, I don't actively do hardly any engineering, right? We have amazing engineers, and there is no reason for me to do it in the same way that there's no reason for me to have a home studio, right?
Yeah.
So, and for me, so I produce stuff, and then I also, you know, I'm an executive producer in a lot of records. And in a lot of cases, you know, after the original, you know, production is plan has been made and set in motion, and, you know, the business aspects of that have been taken care of, you know, I'm a resource when people get stuck. I'm another set of ears that people can send a mix to and say, you know, what are you hearing here? I'm worried, like, you know, somebody just sent me a complete master and said, I think this is good. Everyone else thinks it's good, but I hear a problem in the low mids, or I'm worried that there's a problem in the low mids. So, and I think we sort of benefit. We do these sanity checks on each other. So for me, as a producer and as someone who's sort of giving input on other people's work all the time, giving feedback, for me, the act of producing is sort of consciously stepping away from being too involved in the sort of ticky-tack technical details, even in the musical details to an extent, that I was, you know, I explain it sometimes as saying, it's the difference between, do I dig this and am I digging this? These are two different questions. Do I dig this means I concentrated on it and made a decision as to whether I dig it. And am I digging it means I was already digging it before it occurred to me to ask the question. And you know.
Absolutely. You know, I know exactly what you mean right there.
Eric Wortham does this in the control room. When he's producing something and I'm just hanging out with him, and he looks over to see if my foot's tapping, because I'm never thinking about should I tap my foot or not, you know. Yeah. And it's that acid test. Or, you know, when my son was little, when he was 3 or 4, it was great to be able to, like, play it for a 3 or 4 year old. It's like 3 or 4 year olds have no bullshit. It's like they will not like something because it's happening in daddy's studio. Therefore, it's just like, if, you know, they like music on such a visceral level of, like, either the spark of joy is happening there or it's not happening for that kid. And I think, like, as a producer, I try to make judgments on that level as much as I can. And not, you can't fix things on that level. You fix things by getting engaged with it and working with people to sort of figure out, you know, how can the music be better? How can the sound be better? But a decision as to whether it's any good or not, or whether there's a problem, I'm trying to have that little more detached perspective.
Yeah.
And, like, you know, perspective is really the producer's most important skill. You know, it's the superpowers.
I really like that difference right there, and I will probably steal that and pretend that it's my idea going forward.
But, you know, it's my goal to be imitated. Thank you. That's You honor me. You honor me.
There we go.
So anyway, I have my home studio set up. It's funny. I went on and on about that. It's the least important thing we've done is my home studio. Jeff Hyatt had already built himself a great mix room in his new house. It was sort of always part of his plan. And so the upgrade for him was sort of to say, all right, let's make sure that you can do a detailed mix with, you know, a really great set of plugins that Turtle also has, so that we wouldn't lose the ability to move sessions, mix sessions back and forth between different studios, which can be very important just in terms of being able to get certain things done quickly. So Jeff got a microphone and a bunch of plugins. Ross got several microphones, several great preamps, so that his home studio is no longer just like, it doesn't really matter how good the sound is, I just need to get some ideas down quickly, and then I'll record the real version at Turtle. All right, so for now, we want the version that Ross is doing at home to be a lot better. And so, I mean, we tested all kinds of different tech in terms of how could we deliver great sound quality sort of across the internet, basically in real time. And so we have that set up now. We have really fantastic quality audio, essentially able to be broadcast from our main mix room to anyone's web browser. I was shocked when I heard it. It sounds like, when I heard it in my home studio being broadcast from the Turtle control room, the main mix room, it sounded like it was happening in my own control room. There was no data compression. There was no audio artifacting at all. And it was exciting because I said, oh, I really feel now as a producer that I'm in the room.
Yeah.
And that's a very different feeling than being in a Zoom session, even though a Zoom session is not bad, you know, in some ways. But when you hear the audio and you feel like you're really in the control room, all right, now I really want to get some work done.
It's a big boost of confidence too, on both sides of that situation right there, where everyone feels like they're hearing it properly and they can make the decisions and have the discussions that they want to have about the sound because it sounds like what it's supposed to sound like.
I want you to sort of imagine a situation where, this is not an uncommon situation that comes up for us. You know, Philly is full of these world-class players who go on world tours all the time with major artists, with Lady Gaga, with, you know, Common, with Rihanna, with John Legend, with Adele, obviously. And so these people live all around Philly, and it's not uncommon that one of them will be asked to be like, you know, can you lay down some drums on a track that I'm working on? Can you lay down some keyboard on a track that I'm working on, some piano? And particularly for drums, as a producer, you don't want to just, you know, you can just let a drummer lay down some tracks, but most producers that I know, they want to make sure the drum sound is right also. And if there's anything sketchy about the audio coming remotely to you over the internet, then you can't really evaluate whether the drum sounds are any good. So being able to deliver to a producer anywhere in the world, you know, that the audio really sounds like it does in the control room, it sounds pretty much exactly the same. And in some ways, better that you're listening on your own speakers too. You know, like someone comes, like we have a great control room, we have great monitors, and it's very easy to get used to that control room. And it's a shame that nobody's allowed to go in there right now. But in some ways, it's better that you're listening on your own speakers that you can really evaluate because you're used to it. You know, you're used to what they sound like.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'll tell you an interesting side effect of this is I've talked to a few producers in LA who now seem more interested in working with us than they were a few months ago. The reason being that working with us is no longer any different for them than working with a studio in LA.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're not going to go down to the street and go down to a studio if they don't have to. And if they really could choose anywhere in the world, and we have a nice relationship with some of these people. And yeah, so there has been a lot of interest in that. I mean, it hasn't, I don't want to say that it's happened a lot yet because people are still getting used to the idea, but it's just different. You know, it's just, you know, it's if you can record one person safely and then broadcast great audio of that to the producer in real time so they can evaluate both the music and the sound, there's some things you can get done. It's not the same. And, you know, as things start to reopen, you know, the options will sort of start to branch out from there.
Well, that's kind of what I wanted to get into next, because you sent me a very cool plan that you guys have been working on for a while, essentially called Creating Safely. And that's utilizing all the advantages that you have as a large live room with multiple smaller rooms ringing it and all that, that you can really get things done at Turtle that might not be feasible for a while for a lot of other spaces.
Well, I don't think we're going to be the only space where that's feasible. You know, I'm sure there's other large studios and even, you know, some studios that you would think of as medium size, you know, have the ability, you know, I'm thinking like a little place like Drowning Fish, they can put people in three separate rooms. Mm-hmm. You know, they, you know, this is not, you know, it's not entirely unique, but I think what I'm trying to do is to hopefully start to shape the conversation about how studios are going to reopen. And to, in a sense, provide some ideas for people. And again, you know, I said it jokingly before, but I'm very serious about it on this subject. I hope that we are imitated, because we are going to try to set the highest standard for being thoughtful about safety and for helping people to be safe and to feel safe when they come into the studio. I hope essentially that people are competing with each other on the basis of who can be the most careful, who can demonstrate the most commitment to keeping all the musicians safe and to keeping your own engineers safe and keeping our families safe. You know, mm-hmm. like, it's a virus, you know, it spreads. This is what it does. So what we saw when the shutdown started to happen is I think there was sort of a week where people were still being a little bit reckless. And I had this thought of, oh my God, is it going to be the case that the studios will, you know, that will do well are the ones who are the most careless, are the ones who basically act like it's not that big of a deal. I haven't seen too much of that since late March. I think people sort of got the message and maybe there was some blowback. And if people are doing sessions, they're mostly, on the DL. None of us are scientists that I know of. I don't know of any scientist running a recording studio. I'm actually now consulting with a jazz musician who's also an epidemiologist and sort of like trying to see if he has any special insight into this stuff. But there's going to be diversity of opinion. I have not seen, since the very early days, I have not seen too much that I would sort of think of as recklessness mm-hmm. from my studio peers or colleagues. Gary Dan over at the Boom Room, which is, it's a rehearsal place, but he does recording there, and he has maybe the best multimedia setup preceding this whole situation of anyone. And so he didn't have to do anything to get ready to start streaming concerts out. And it was a great opportunity for him in that sense. And like us, and I really applaud Gary for this, like us, he realized right away, it's actually not appropriate to do this. It's not safe to do it. I did a Facebook post about this. It's like, yeah, we're ready to do this. It's illegal to do this. Yeah. And it's irresponsible to do this. And I mean, you know me, I'm a very much a pro-science guy. I'm not going to be the one leading the way on either denying science or endangering people. That's not who I am. It's not what Turtle Studios is about at all. And actually, I'm concerned in that we're now releasing, you know, that plan that you have, creating safely. I've been concerned all along that I would hate for anyone to misinterpret that as any kind of push to make reopening happen sooner. I don't want it to happen any sooner than it ought to happen. I'm trusting in, I'm certainly trusting in scientific leaders. And I think that we have a pretty great governor in Pennsylvania. And also, you know, I'm over the bridge in New Jersey. Arguably, New Jersey's governor has done the best job of anyone. Doesn't get much press. I trust that when those guys, when those specific governors say it's okay to reopen in Philadelphia now, and to what extent it's okay to reopen, we're going to follow those guidelines mm-hmm. pretty much to the letter. I want to make sure that people understand I'm not trying to push to make that happen any sooner. But we have already started doing the work of figuring out how can we make things as safe as possible and how can we present almost a menu of options to, you know, because like I said, when we work with every artist, there's a very specific plan that comes from discussions with that artist about what their vision is about their record. Well, there's also going to have to be a very specific plan now anytime that multiple people are getting together at the studio. And I was just talking to an artist last night who has an 11-piece group. And we talked about, can we do some stuff with smaller breakout versions of the group? Certain songs? Are there other songs that we could put people in different rooms in different parts of the building? Because again, like, we have the whole building wired up. We can put people not only in different isolation booths, but in entirely other parts of the building that don't even share the same air conditioning system. So it's really, it can be very isolated, but obviously you're going to lose something when you do that. It's going to work. It's going to, like, in terms of the timing and the audio and the latency, it's fine. It's the same as being in the same room, but it's not going to feel the same as being in the same room. But, you know, people are trying to figure this out now.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is the point, is it's sort of a whole new topic of trade-offs between production quality and safety. And it's going to be, you know, people, there's going to be masks. We have face shields ready for people. Disc Makers makes face shields. Everyone should order them. and you know, we're going to build other safety barriers. And we're going to basically have a menu of options of saying, what makes you feel safe? What are you comfortable with? And also, we have our own lines that we're not going to cross either. Actually, mm-hmm. one of the things, it doesn't go into this in the document I shared with you, but in our emerging safety protocol, so we have a safety protocol right now at Turtle. And it's an actual document. And anyone who comes into Turtle, you know, has to read and abide by that document. And anyone basically gets interrogated about what are their personal safety practices, how safe have they kept themselves. And obviously interrogated isn't the right word. Nobody feels interrogated.
Yeah.
If anything, this is a very odd thing. There's a sense of relief as I'm talking to someone and I'm asking them about all the details of how isolated they've been. And they realize that I'm asking everyone those questions.
Yeah.
And they realize that nobody is coming into Turtle and nobody is going to be coming into Turtle without us airing this out a little bit, at least not in the next few months, you know, maybe later in the year, maybe next year, you know, with this, you know, these documents, these recommendations, they're going to change every week. We're going to find out new things about the virus. We're going to, and how it spreads. Like this week, they're saying it, maybe it doesn't really spread on contact with surfaces very much at all. All right, I'm not ready to start being less careful with that, but we're going to keep that in mind and sort of going forward about, you know, how much detail we're putting into each aspect of this. But it's going to change. And what I told this artist with the 11-piece group is, I said, whatever subset of the group we bring into the studio, I think it's very important that you let us all talk together and that we have a Zoom meeting or whatever it's going to be and really make clear to everybody involved, as I have to Turtle's engineers, everyone involved has veto power over everything now. That if anyone feels unsafe, I don't want them coming in and being part of the session. We need to do something differently, or they need to understand that if they excuse themselves from the session, that nobody's going to hold it against them. I mean, some of these people are immunocompromised.
Yeah.
You can't ask them to come in and feel unsafe at all. It's not, it's crazy.
Yeah.
It's not just about that they're being safe, that we're all being safe, but that they feel safe, that they feel safe enough that they can relax and actually get lost in the music.
Yeah, make a record the way that we used to make records, where you just, you hole up for a week or a few days or whatever, and you just kind of lose yourself in the project. It's hard to lose yourself in a project if you're constantly worried, am I far enough away from this guy? All right, I'm going to move into this room now, which means that someone has to move out of that room and into this room.
Right.
But as we've talked before...
Well, people will get used to some of that stuff.
Yeah, sure. And it just, at the core of every good production session, in the best of times or not, at the core of every good production session is planning. And it sounds like, at first, this is a lot of extra planning. But once you get the rhythm down of how this is going to go going forward, then, like, it's not going to be too terribly different than deciding, you know, well, what player is going to play on what, and how do we schedule that, and, you know, what equipment are we using and things. This is just another level of production planning that, you know, we probably never foresaw, but here we are.
What, you know, what I think is going to increase is communication with individual members of each band. That comfort level is going to have to be reached with everyone who's involved. And before this, if I'm talking to an individual member of a band, like, let's say I'm producing a record for a band leader. All right, well, I'll give you an example. I produced a record with Lucas Brown, great organist and composer, that came out a few months ago. Great record. Check it out. I would talk to him, and we would make sort of general plans of how we're going to do different things. And then I would say, all right, I'm going to reach out to the drummer and talk about the drums. I'm going to reach out to the guitarist and talk about different ways for us to approach the guitar sound. But I wouldn't necessarily but I don't have to talk to the sax player. I don't have to talk to the trumpet player. There are certain members of the band where these back channel communications just become very practical, mm-hmm. like, because you're not talking about the artistic vision of the record, or at least you should already understand the artistic vision of the record enough to have that conversation. You know, those conversations, I feel like at least at some point in the early stages, we're going to have those kinds of connections with almost every person who comes into the studio.
Mm-hmm.
and make sure, because one thing is I want them to know everything we're doing to make them safe, to keep them safe. I want them to know that they have a few different options to be made safe in the situation, and sort of talk through with them a few different ways we could do things. And I don't know that I could be comfortable that each individual person feels safe unless I really hear it from them directly. You could understand if maybe there is a role for an intermediary to make sure that everybody really feels safe about safety. And again, honestly, I'm just riffing here. This is totally off the top of my head, but you know, I've been thinking about this for over a month, and new ideas still come up almost every day as to like, how is this going to play out and what role can we play to be helpful? So it seems to me right now like it's going to look like that. 4 months from now, it might not look anything like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
We're going to have to keep adapting and keep planning it one session at a time.
I think the fact that you guys are even thinking about it is a huge thing. And the fact that you've gone so far as to really try and draw out some plans. And then it's the idea in the background. And I've heard this from you, and I've heard this from other people in the field too lately. The idea that whatever plan you come up with, it needs to be not fluid in terms of the way that it's executed, but the ideas behind it need to be changeable. Like, you can't just make a whole bunch of edicts and regulations and then never move from them. They may need to be more stringent. They may be able to be less stringent, and you need to be able to kind of bob and weave on that. And it seems to me that's what you guys have in mind as well.
Well, again, there's two factors. There's a time factor. Our knowledge and the best practices and even legal requirements are going to change. You know, who's actually going to provide a lot of leadership on this is unions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, unions are negotiating, and specifically like a union like IATSE is working on this right now, of saying, what are the safety measurements that are being taken to protect our members?
Yeah.
You know, and so that's one of the many things that we can study and say, like, all right, what is being negotiated for union members right now? And let's make sure that we are taking all the best input we can from that and from everything, just about like, what are the different ways that we can make people safe? And, you know, I think a lot of what people are trying to gauge right now, and a lot of why there's essentially been silence from almost everybody about this, is that nobody really knows what to think. Like, what is a reasonable amount of safety? What would that look like? What would it feel like? You know, and I think that for a lot of us, I don't know about you, like, I definitely think that there's a role that sort of socialization plays in our sanity checking ourselves. And it's just saying, am I crazy for expecting a certain amount of safety? Am I crazy for not doing that? And there are going to be bands that are just going to get together and record in a small studio next week, I guess.
Yeah.
But it's not going to be at Turtle. If you've got musicians who tend to be more off the cuff and careless about the details, and the musicians who are more thoughtful and careful about the details, that second group of musicians is generally who we work with and also who we want to work with.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there might be some overlap in the, like, people who are really thoughtful and careful about their musicianship and how a record is going to come out, and people who are careful about their safety also. And so, you know, it just sort of, I don't know, we'll see how that plays out, but I think that it might track a little.
No, I agree with you right there. I think people who put thought into the thing that they do every day, be it a musical craft or something like that, you find in the end that they're pretty thoughtful about a lot of things.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I would hate to just totally make that as a blanket assumption.
Sure.
But just the idea that we're going to try to appeal to the most careless people, and by doing that also endanger ourselves and our families.
Yeah.
That strikes me as not a great idea. It's not. Well, that's not for us. We'll let somebody else do that.
It sounds like you guys have a lot to still figure out, but it sounds like you're definitely.
Hell yeah.
But you guys are, you guys and hopefully a lot of other people like you are thinking these things through, having these conversations, and not just hitting it from the bottom line. You know what I mean? Like, you could make a whole set of decisions based strictly on the financial well-being of the studio and nothing else. But you're not. And hopefully a lot of other people take that same attitude as well.
I don't know. You know what? A friend of mine sent me an idea for like some sort of online seminar that we could do. And it had nothing to do with this, and it was, I sent her a reply. I said, this is a great idea. I like the part where we would all make money, but I think it requires a certain level of being full of crap, and we're just not up to that level. You know, maybe we could manage to be, I mean, yeah. You know, Ross,
yeah.
You know, I don't know if you, how well you know Jeff Hyatt or, like, you know, any of the people at Turtle, they're almost sort of they're not devious people. No. You know, they're very good-hearted people, and there isn't a bottom line answer for us where we would make money by being less safe that we could live with. It's not an option for us. We have to do this in a way that's aligned with our values and hopefully succeed that way, because that's the only way for us to succeed. And that's how I see it.
Well, I'm glad you guys are doing the work, and hopefully this becomes a bit of a, like, movement is maybe too grand a term to put to it, but you hope that it starts to stir up conversation in your industry and in a lot of the other aspects of the music industry and entertainment industry. Who's to say that some of the ideas that you come up with don't somehow find a way to transpose over to the venue world and things like that? These are all things that everyone has to be thinking about.
Yeah, man, they've got their whole other batch of problems at venues.
Yep.
I don't even know if they have the budget to pay for, you know, to pay for a building to be open if it can only be at 30% capacity or something like that. They've, you know,
you're being asked to, you know, make your rent or make your lease at 50% or less capacity. And
well, we have that problem.
Yeah, but you understand why a lot of these places shut down and will stay shut down regardless of what order is given by, you know, governments or health officials, because they say, look, you may say it's safe for me to pack this place half full, and I'm with you on that, but it doesn't pay the bills right now.
Because this stretches out to every aspect of how the live music business is structured, too. It's like, how big of a touring operation do you have, you know? My friend with the 11-piece group, how do you pay the 11-piece group? How big of a room do you need to sell out for that? All right, well, now that room is only, you know, 25% full. Can you still pay everyone in that band? Maybe not.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's a bit. So that's a value proposition for the artists that they're going to have to figure out on their side. That's before you even get into the fact of, like, how many stages can we
can
have 11 people?
Can we even do
on?
This?
You know, that's right. So there's going to be that, and then there's the question of how many customers need to be in the building, how much alcohol do they need to be drinking in order for the venue being open to make sense, you know, and then how much money do they lose if they're not open versus how much do they lose if, you know, do we open up and make a loss this week, this month, but just much less of a loss than we otherwise would have. And it's really hard, like with so many things in this crisis. I'm glad not to have those problems. Mm-hmm. You know, like I have my own problems. It's stressful. It's emotionally daunting and draining for, I think, almost everybody. But, you know, but I don't have the problem of a venue, and the venues in some sense have the worst problems. I mean, as a company, there are individual people who have much worse problems, you know, and that's been, you know, what I'm grateful for is that, you know, at least so far, everyone at Turtle, everyone that I have any responsibility for, everyone's reasonably healthy. Everyone is in a reasonably stable housing situation. And actually, just by sort of pure luck, pretty much everyone involved with Turtle is with a great person who is their spouse or partner. And it's sort of like, it's good to sort of feel like I don't have to worry too much about the individual people. And I know a lot of people are in much worse situations than we are. So I always say, I have so much to complain about, but I really don't feel that I can complain.
And I've never been this kind of person in my brain until recently, but I've been trying to make a conscious effort where every time I want to complain about something or I just want to bitch about something, I force myself to conjure up three things that I am just so incredibly grateful either still exist for me or are still available to me. And I, you know me, man, I'm a sarcastic punk from way back, but like this, it's helping. It's helping massively. Like it's helping my mental well-being to, like, you know, that old adage, that terrible adage that I'd roll my eyes out of, count your blessings. But like in these moments, like I literally have to.
There are people who are living every day with an enormous amount of risk, and I'm not one of those people. You know, I have sort of a moderate risk factor for my personal health and age and everything, but I'm not low risk, but there are people with my risk profile who are essential workers and who have to go out every day and live their life with a lot more risk of exposure than I have. And yeah, like I said, I I can't complain. There's so much right in front of us of people who have real problems, and you know, I have problems, but in the context of the crisis right now, I don't have real problems.
Yeah, no, I feel exactly the same way. Yeah, yeah. Well, this is great. I'm glad that you wanted to talk about the studio and the plans and going forward. I think it's good that there are people who are starting to talk about this, and I'll emphasize it again, because you've already said it a few times, that you guys are in no way trying to blaze the trail for a quick and effective rebound and opening. You guys are just simply asking the questions and starting to put some of the pieces together of what does an open studio look like? Not what does a normal open studio like it was a year ago look like, but what does it look like now? And just the amount of carefulness, the amount of thoughtfulness is just, it's remarkable and very, very refreshing, especially from an industry where it seems like we only ever hear the shark feeding stories on, you know what I mean?
I mean, that's kind of you. And I will say, you know, I can be fairly catty and competitive about other people in recording, but I have to say overall, I think there are some really good people in recording. And, anytime I get a chance to hang out with people who are running another studio, I always end up liking that person a lot more than I want to. and I think there's something about it. Like if you're not a good person who's trying to help people and that you basically get along with people and that they feel that you have good intentions, you can't really survive in music to some extent.
Certainly not run a studio.
There are certain bad actors out there, but I know a lot of really good people in studios, and I hope that we're going to see, and I'm optimistic that we're going to see a lot of studios doing the right thing and taking care of people and being thoughtful about safety. And if I can contribute to that in any way, then, you know, that would be great. Yeah.
Well, it's great, man. Thanks so much for talking about it. I hope you're staying safe. It sounds like everyone's doing their best to be safe and to continue doing so.
Like I said, can't complain. Yeah. Glad you're doing okay.
Yeah.
And this was long overdue. We need to, some point, we need to tape the episode that we meant to do 2 years ago, where we actually talk about recording and different artists and different projects.
And you, and like, I know so little about your attachment to music yourself. Like, I mean, I know you're a fan, and I don't know what you play or anything like that, or if you play anything at all. No, and that's a whole other conversation. We're not going to have that conversation right now. We'll be on here for another long period of time. But that is a conversation I want to have in the future, hopefully in person.
Yeah, that would be great. Yeah. So it's we will schedule a beer for
2021.
1 to 2 years from
2021.
Now.
We'll pencil it in.
We'll be together till the end. 25
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Jay Levin, for talking with me, for laying out the beginnings of a constantly changing and evolving plan for not just Turtle Studios, but hopefully a lot of other studios take a look at this and start to fashion their own safety standards and health safety standards in their studios, using this as a jumping off point. You know, it all has to start somewhere. Someone has to start the conversation, and I'm glad to have gotten to have this conversation with Jay. Like I said at the top of the show, you can go to turtlestudios.bandcamp.com to check out a whole bunch of music that comes out of that place. Really killer stuff, all genres, all styles, all people. It's a truly great studio. And go to facebook.com/turtlestudios to read their drafting, their note on the beginnings of these safety standards that they're trying to come up with and trying to figure out. So thank you, Jay. Thank you, Turtle Studios. Thank you, everyone. I hope everyone's safe out there, not just physically, but in your mind as well. And stay safe, stay well, stay active. Try and help in whatever way that is. Maybe that's not going out in the streets with a sign, but maybe it's in donating money. Maybe it's in just explaining to people who might not really know what's going on here, and why there are so many people out there so angry right now with the police and with other groups. I think we can do a lot to help other people understand what's going on. So that's my piece on that right there. I'm certainly no expert, and I'm not going to jump out and try and be a band leader on it. That's not my place. But hey, do what you can, help who you can. My name is Dan Drago. You've been listening to 25 O'Clock. Until next time, take care of yourselves.